Hi everyone, welcome to the linear programming course. My name is Yuri Burda. I will be your instructor for this term. So first, some info about me. Here's my email, and it's important, if you have any questions, if you want to schedule an appointment, if you want to meet me and talk to me, that's the way I do it, send me an email. My office is in Air Science Building. It's not close to here, but that's where it is. On the fourth floor, room 4109. Another important thing is the website. There's a website for our section. And it is also important because, first of all, I'll post some announcements there. Kind of, if I remember something, I'll just put there. And another thing, I will try to record all the lectures, so almost all the lectures. And as you see, there is a camera over there. And I will put the videos on YouTube and put the links here. So if you miss a class or don't want to come early in the morning, or for whatever reason, if you can't, if you want to see the lecture once again, here's the link. I will not talk today about the other administrative stuff, like what is the marking scheme, the kind of any registration issues. I won't give you my office hours. The reason is I just don't know. We have two instructors for the course and we have to coordinate. We still didn't have a chance to. So I'll talk about this on Tuesday. Otherwise, we have a book for this course. It's Linear Programming by Shvatal, and it looks like this. I must admit that this book is not kind of, it's not awesome. It's readable, but not very, very good. So, I mean, in the beginning it will be okay. Later it will become kind of compressed and hard to understand. So we'll see what we'll do with this.
What's
340 linear programming.
Okay, math 340.
Okay.
14 or 4?
4-0.
340.
Okay. So before I start kind of talking about the material of the course, so what we are going to talk in the course in general, any questions that might interest kind of on administrative stuff? Yeah?
So, since you're videotaping this, does it mean we're going to have video lectures as well?
Yes, so I am going to videotape it. I'm not sure about the quality, but I will try to optimize for the quality kind of during the semester. I will be putting the videos on YouTube and I'll put the links to the videos here. So hopefully you will be able to watch the videos online. Other questions? Okay, so let me talk a little bit about what is linear programming and let me kind of advertise the course a little bit. I mean, you're already here, but still, if I will give an advertisement, it will be in the first lecture. So what is linear programming about? It's about problems of optimization. You want to optimize some business, some manufacturing, some schedule, different things. And, you have encountered some problems about optimization. You have taken probably calculus, and there you had some problems which amounted to, here's a function, say one variable, and you want to find its maximal value on a given interval. And you did something. You found derivative, equated to zero, compared some values, and in this way you found the largest value of some function on a given interval. Compared to what we are going to do here, it is complicated stuff. What do I mean? In this course we'll discuss only very, very simple functions. Functions for which the concept of derivative it does make sense, but it is almost empty. It doesn't produce new information. We'll talk about functions which look kind of, in one dimension they look like a line. They will be called linear. And we'll be talking about maximizing linear functions, both, and we'll have some domain for the variables, for the parameters which go into the function, and the domain will also be described by some linear functions. So we'll be talking about optimization problems, which are the simplest kind in some sense. By this I mean linear. But the surprising thing is, in applications, such problems do appear, and they appear frequently enough so that it is a good idea to devote a whole course just to studying these kind of simplest problems. They are not, of course, they don't cover everything. They don't cover the whole domain of optimization. There is a whole much larger domain of nonlinear optimization, but we won't touch on this. So let me give you some examples of the kinds of problems that we are going to discuss. So some examples. And now just talk qualitatively, with no numbers, with no actual equations, just what kind of problems we are going to discuss. So one example is, say, optimizing maximizing profit of, say, a manufacturing business. So you have a business that produces something, or maybe several kinds of products, and what you want to do is somehow find the best way to allocate resources, your equipment time, your labor, your actual physical resources like plastic, wood, whatever you're buying to produce your stuff. And you want to get the maximal profit. That's what usually you want. This problem is quite general, and in the general form it's not in the domain of our course. But under some assumptions, it will be the kind of problem we are going to discuss. So what kind of assumptions? We'll assume that the cost of each product costs the same amount to produce, so say you're producing calculators, and for the calculator you need some electronic components, some plastic, some paint maybe. So the cost of all the materials that you required for the first calculator is assumed to be the same as the cost of the materials which are required for the 1,000th one or 1,000,000th one. It's not really kind of a good assumption. In actual world, there might be some economies of scales, maybe producing 1,000,000th item costs you less than producing the first one, but we will only discuss such kind of things. Well, also selling price all products sell for the same price. So once again, the assumption that the revenue that you get from selling the first calculator is the same as the revenue that you get from selling 1,000,000th calculator. Once again, not a realistic assumption maybe, but that's the kind of assumption that we'll be discussing in our course. And the amount of maybe resources that go into producing each item is also constant. So there are some assumptions which limit the domain of problems that we are going to discuss. But under these assumptions, we will be able to solve such problems. So I'll give you several more examples of kind of categories of problems that we will be discussing, some scheduling problems. You might have several workers, you have different qualifications, you have several tasks, and well, the different workers have different efficiencies at doing some tasks, and you want to optimize the amount of work that gets done. How to allocate the, how to schedule the time of the workers to the actual tasks. So once again, not all scheduling problems fall into the domain of linear programming, but under some assumptions, for example, one assumption in real world, if you take a worker and put it to work on some task for, I don't know, 1,000 hours, in the end he will get much more efficient. Well, that's not in the domain of linear programming. For us, say, the efficiency of worker is constant. So you see, there is some pattern to what kind of assumptions we have. Some things don't change with time. They don't change with our choices, how we allocate resources. So efficiency of each worker does not change. The cost of each product does not change. The price of each product does not change. And in each kind of problems, in each kind of categories that we'll be discussing, we will have some such limiting assumptions. But still, in the first approximation, even analyzing such problems is very, very useful. So let me discuss some other kind of problems, maybe transportation problems. What kind of problem this is? You have several, I don't know, cities or manufacturing facilities, and you have some suppliers, you have some consumers. You produce something in city A, you want to consume it in city B. And vice versa, in city B you produce something else and you want to transport it to city C. And some of it also should go to city A, and you have such a network of roads between the cities, and well, they have different taxes. The cost of transporting, I don't know, calculator from A to B is such and such. The cost of transporting a computer from A to D is such and such. And the question is, well, how to schedule the best kind of how to find the best way to transport all the goods from all the suppliers to all the consumers. And once again, here we'll have some assumptions. We'll hit the cost of transporting just one product from one city to another does not depend on which product it is. The first product or one millionth one. In other words, transporting, say, 500 products from A to B will cost you twice less than transporting 1,000 of those. So some kind of linearity constraint like this. Okay, so other domains. So these problems are, they have very applied spirit. They are actual problems that you want to solve. There are also some theoretical applications that we'll be discussing, more or less theoretical. So we'll discuss pricing of resources. So you have a business, you want to pay salaries to workers, you have limited amount of workers, and you want to understand how much is each one of the workers how well you go into one of those things. So we'll discuss such problems once again in some statistics. We'll discuss problems from game theory. We'll discuss some games. Well, they. I'm not sure that we'll have time to discuss those, but once again, there is a certain class of games which can be analyzed using the theory that we'll have in this course. We might talk about applications of combinatorics, graph theory, maybe I forgot something. And kind of approximate solutions. Overdetermined systems. So there are really, really a lot of applications of basically the same idea. So we'll be discussing kind of just one idea for a long, long time in this course, but then this idea will turn out to be useful in a huge range of applications. As you see here, the schedules, well, they are quite different. I didn't even explain what kind of things we're discussing here or here, but still, just by looking at the names of these things, you should realize that they are really, really different applications, but they have the same kind of mathematics behind them. So in the first part of the course, at least, we will be discussing just the mathematics. And later, if we have time, we'll discuss some of the applications. Let me tell you just a little bit about the history of the subject. The subject is, well, somewhat recent. It was I can't say it was discovered in the 20th century. I mean, some kind of rudimentary version of linear programming existed in the 19th century, but it was realized that this is very, very useful and can be applied to actual real-life problems only in the 20th century, in the 30s and 40s. And in the 40s it was applied to, well, in kind of military setting, how to optimize the manufacturing of weapons and such stuff. Before this, it was applied to just manufacturing problems, and it was really kind of a shock to people to realize that there is a simple mathematical technique that can improve production or can improve outcomes in business by just, well, having the same amount of resources, the same amount of capital, same amount of workers, just moving them more efficiently, kind of assigning them more efficiently to the tasks, well, improves the outcomes, improves the profit, improves, well, the amount of work done. And when people started applying this idea, I mean, it was really crazy. You have a plant, it produces something, you come there and you ask, well, what kind of process do you have, what kind of constraints do you have, what kind of, well, what do you want to optimize? You apply some very simple calculation that we'll talk about, and then you improve, well, the profit by typically kind of from 5% in the low range if the manufacturing was well optimized, to more typical kind of 40%, 50%. So it was really big deal. And in the West, the guy who invented it was Danzig. In Soviet Union, it was Kantorovich. And eventually, Kantorovich got a Nobel Prize in economics for inventing this linear programming and applying it to actual problems. But it was kind of a funny story, because, I mean, they didn't really know about what the other guy was doing. They discovered the method independently, Danzig and Kantorovich. I mean, there wasn't really that much communication between Soviet Union and the rest. And so Danzig actually worked on this for a long, long time and applied it. So he popularized it, applied it to actual problems. With Kantarovich, the story is much more sad. He, well, tried to apply it in Soviet Union, but, well, pretty soon he was banned from actually doing any research on this, and the reason was, well, I mean, it's hard to say what is the real reason, but the official reason was as follows. We'll discuss this topic, duality and pricing of resources, and Kantarovich invented this theory, and he realized that there are some prices that have to be assigned to resources, and those are, they're not just artifacts of how much do I want to pay such and such worker. No, they're actually objective prices. They are how much this and this such and such worker is valuable to me, and that's the amount that I value him. And he called these prices objective prices. And the communists said, we have Marxist economy, there is no such thing as objective prices, nothing has an objective price, and they banned him from any research on this. And it took some time until they realized that the technique is very efficient and somebody should be doing this, and they saw that in the West it was being applied, and we should do the same, and only later, kind of by the end of the war, of the Second World War, they allowed him to do research once again. But it was kind of, they were quite a bit behind by that time. Okay, so maybe any questions about this general thing about, I didn't present too many details, so maybe there aren't really questions to be asked here. So let me make it more concrete. Let me discuss some particular problem. We won't solve it today, but at least we'll formulate. We'll start with a problem formulated in words. We'll translate it to a problem, kind of a standard problem in mathematics, not about the real world, just about mathematics. So the problem is as follows. I thought yesterday what kind of example to present here, and I looked at the class list and I saw that I have people from economics, mathematics, electrical engineering, somebody is from psychology. So it was hard to choose an example, but then I realized that, all of you are students, so we have such a problem. You, or some student, are preparing a study for an exam. For three exams. Should be a familiar situation. So you study for three exams in subjects A, B, and C. You have one day for A and B, and 2 days for C. So let's say that the exams are late in the evening, and today you want to study for A and B, and today and tomorrow you want to study for C. So it looks kind of like this. You have two exams A and B in the end of the first day, and you have exam C in the end of the second day. And all this time, you can study. hear something about this stage. You know, already you know 65% of the material of A. And you also know 40% of the material of B. And you know just 20% of the material of C. So we assume that in this course you kind of remember what happened during the term. In these courses, though, you remember a little bit less. And then, well, the courses have different difficulties. Each hour of studying for A subjects have different levels of difficulty. The easiest one of those is C. You see that for each hour that you spend studying for this exam C, you learn 12% of the material. And the most difficult is B. But this is not the end. Also, because you have such a tight schedule, you study all the day, and in the evening you have exams, well, you get tired, and the following happens. For each hour of studying, the brain for all the exams on the same day drops by 3%, and on the next day by 1%. So, studying is hard and you get tired, so if you study for 8 hours today, well, for the exams that you are going to do today, you will get 8 times 3%, 24 points less than the amount of material that you actually need. Okay, so it's kind of funny story about how it works, and also once you are tired for several days, you're less tired for tomorrow, but still, it has effects on you. And the question is, well, you want somehow to get the best grades. Now, it's hard to say what kind of grades are best. Is it better to get kind of 20, 100, 100, or 50, 50, 50, or, well, you have to choose some kind of measure of how well you perform on the three tests combined. And there are some choices to be made, and it might depend on your preference, kind of, in the first year, in the last year, it might depend on different things, but this particular student decided he wants to optimize, maximize the average grade. once he gets the grades, well, he will measure how well he succeeded by just taking the average of the three grades. And the question is, well, how should he spend his 16 hours of studying? Oh, I didn't tell, and it was important. I didn't tell that you can only study for 8 hours a day. So we can tell it now. The question is how to do this. You can study it only 8 hours a day. So you see, you have infinitely many options in this problem. You can say, on the first day, study for exam A, ignore exam B altogether, and on the second day, study for exam C. That's one option. It will produce some results. Well, you will learn some amount of material. According to this schedule, you'll get tired to some extent. And then this will be reflected in your grade in the exams A, B, and C. You'll get some grades, you'll get some average, well, one data point. You can spend your resources in different manners. Say, on the first day, split your time equally between studying for A and B, kind of 4 hours and 4 hours. And on the second day, study for 6 hours for exam C, rest for 2 hours, and well, go to the exams. It will produce something different. So on second day you'll get less tired, but you'll learn less material for C. So compared to the previous option, you'll learn more about B, a little bit less about A. You will still get tired, so you'll get some grades, another data point. And you see that you have infinitely many options. So you have to make some choices. Should you study for exam number C on the first day, or should you devote the first day only to A and B? Should you allow yourself some time to rest, or should you, or are you better off devoting it to studying? These are all questions which, well, are hard to answer by just looking at this problem. I mean, you can look at these numbers. I mean, you can try to guess something about the answer, but you are not likely to get the actual best possible strategy. So what this course is about is taking such a problem, first step, formulating it in kind of standard mathematical way, like in calculus you have one problem about optimizing some function, well, optimizing some quantity. Then you said, well, in mathematical terms, it's just about finding the maximal value of such and such function on such and such interval, or such and such domain. So the first step is translate such a problem to some kind of standard mathematical problem. Second step is, well, depending on whether you have access to a computer with some good software, or you are, well, actually working by hand, either apply the algorithm that will learn how to solve such problems, or, well, translate the problem into a form that the computer will understand and ask it to solve the problem. Well, and then mathematically this will be the end of the story. We'll get some optimal solution, the best possible way to allocate our resources. But practically it will be not the end. We might get some results which are not satisfying. And then we might have to change the problem itself. Because, well, sometimes you think that you want something. For example, here you might think that you want to maximize the average. But maybe the best strategy produces results like 100, 49, and 100. Well, and then you'll realize that's not exactly what you wanted. You didn't really want it 100, 49, and 100, even though it maximizes the average somehow maybe wanted kind of 95, 60 and 95, even though the average will be lower. Well, in this example, the same. So 95, 51 and 95. Maybe this is better for you, even though the average is lower. Well, so sometimes there are kind of third step. Modify the problem to actually suit what you wanted the problem to be and solve it once again. So we'll discuss the first of these steps today, how to take such a problem and find some standard way, mathematical expression for what you are trying to do. We'll discuss the second step, how to solve this problem in the next 7 weeks, I guess. And we'll discuss the last step, how to change the problem or how to solve the problem which is similar but a little bit different, so towards the end of the course. Okay, so first, any questions about the formulation of the problem? Is it clear what we are trying to do? Okay, so let's try to formulate this problem in mathematical language without referring to the actual situation, without referring to exams, students, studying strategies and so on, just what is the mathematical thing that we are trying to do? What kind of function we are trying to optimize, maximize, on what kind of domain, under what kind of constraints? So first of all, we should choose some parameters. Our answer will consist of the following data. How much should I study for exam A on the first day? How much I should study for exam B on the first day? How much I should study for exam C on the first day? Well, how much I should rest on the first day? But it may be kind of too much. It's obvious that if you know how much you study, you also know how much you rest. Because of, you have just 8 hours to allocate. And also, for the second day, you should only study for exam number C. You already went to exams A and B. So we have the following parameters. Let me call them XA, XB, XC on the first day, and XC on the second day. We'll have each solution of the problem, each kind of strategy will be described for us by four numbers. First number, number of hours studying for A. And of course, this happens on Thursday, on day one. Same thing for B. This one is same thing for C on day one. So how much you will study for exam C on the first day? And the last parameter is how much you will study for C on day two. So I should introduce this parameter, how much you study on day two, for example, number C, even though we know that, on day number two, we must study for exam C. We should not study for exams A and B, they happened yesterday. But still, we have a choice. We can devote the whole 8 hours to studying for exam C, or we can devote only part of this to exam C and rest for the other part. So we still have a parameter which can be changed. Yeah.
Well, for this set, we have to know if this time we study for exam C on the second day will be before or after the exams of A and B?
Let's say that it happens exactly like in this picture. You have the exams late in the evening, both A, B, and C. Okay. And you study from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Mm-hmm. And you have these 8 hours to to allocate to all the three activities, studying for A, studying for B, studying for C, so catching four activities and taking a break. So here, this time you'll be allocating kind of, you study for A, you study for B, you study for C, and then you take a break. It doesn't really matter in what order you do this because, so, according to this problem, you don't know. It doesn't matter in what order you study, you still, for each hour that you spend, you learn, say, 10% of material for A, and so on. So it doesn't depend on what order you choose. So, and on the second day, you can just some amount of studying for exam 2, for exam C, a break again. Chosen our parameters. These are the things, the numbers which will completely describe our strategy. Next thing is, so we are trying to maximize something. If you know your strategy, according to the rules of this game, of this problem, you will know what kind of grades you are going to get. And then you will know what kind of average you will get. And then you should be able to express this function, the function that you are trying to maximize in terms of these parameters. So let's try to do this. This is a little bit less obvious. Just choose the parameters. So maybe I'll ask for that. So I'll discuss the objective function, the thing which we are trying to maximize. In this case, the average of the three grades. Average of grades. So I want the average. Perhaps a good idea would be just find out what is the grade A, what is the grade B, what is the grade for C, given this strategy. So let's do this. Grade for A. Maybe somebody can tell me where to start.
10 times, I say.
Okay, so for the exam A, I studied for XA numbers, XA hours. Well, let's figure out first how much material I will learn by studying for this amount of time for exam A. Well, I already knew 65% of the material. So if I don't study anything, I already know 65% of material. Well, but then I spend XA hours actually studying. Well, each of these XA hours gives me 10% of new knowledge. So it's additional 10% multiplied by XA hours. This is the amount of material that I will know by the end of the day. But this is not the grade. This is just the amount of material that I know. Why is this not the grade?
Minus.
Yes, I have this assumption that I get tired. And how much do I get tired? So I have this instrumental effect of studying for long hours, and according to the formulation of the problem, for each hour that I study on this day, how many hours did I study on the first day?
XA.
Well, not just XA. It's XA plus XB plus XC1. So it doesn't matter for which exam I study, I still get tired. So it's XA hours studying for A plus XB hours studying for B plus XC1 hours studying for C on the first day. And for each hour that I studied, well, I lose 3 points in the end of, in the end, on the exam. Okay, so this is the grade that I'm going to get for exam A. Well, you might argue that kind of exam doesn't really reflect the knowledge exactly, like this amount of material is not exactly what you're going to get, but if it's a good exam, this is kind of the expected value of the grade that you're going to get. So it's your best possible guess.
Shouldn't it allow you to be able to get a grade over 100, though?
Yes, we should. I mean, for now I'm just discussing what I'm trying to maximize. Then I'll discuss also what kind of constraints I have. For example, there will be something about I can't study for more than 8 hours. There will be something about the grade not being over 100 ever. So yes, there will be something. But this will not be here. This is just if I employ this strategy, if I manage to employ this strategy, what kind of grade I'm going to get. So I would say that this problem of the grade never being more than 100 is not even, it's about whether your strategy is possible. You can't possibly study more than 100 material per course, because you just have 100% material per course. So it's about whether such and such strategy is kind of reasonable. Okay, and similarly, we can argue for B and C, so grade. So the 40 plus 8% for each hour of studying and minus the same amount of kind of penalty for studying. And also we'll have a grade for C. So we learn, we start with 20% of material, we learn 12% of material by studying on the first day and on the second day. So that's the total amount of studying with MC. For each hour we gain knowledge of 12% of the material, but then we get tired. On the second day we spend XC2 our studying, and each of those gives me a penalty of 3 points on the exam. And they also have tiredness left over from the first day. So the total amount of hours that I studied on the first day, XA plus XB plus XC1 times 1. So now I know that once I will employ such strategy, I will get such grades. And now I can tell what kind of function I'm trying to maximize, the average of these three amounts. Sorry, I'm a little bit lost this time. Is it kind of the end of the lecture right now? Sorry? Okay, I see. So it's until 11. Okay, good. Thanks. Okay, so let's formulate this average, if let's write it down. I guess we're going to erase this part. So average is 1/3 of the sum of these three numbers. This is 5 plus 10 xa minus 3. Plus 40 plus 8 b minus 3 plus 8 plus 8 b plus 8 1 plus 20 plus 12 x 1 plus x 2 minus 3 x 2 minus A plus X B plus X one. And of course it doesn't make sense, well, to overcomplicate things. This looks like a huge complicated function, but actually it isn't that complicated. If you just open the brackets and you see how many times it has X A, how many times it has X B, it will become much simpler. In fact, it will be, you know, so it will be 1/3 of 125, that's the sum. Let's say xa, you will have 10 xa minus 3 times xa minus another 3 times and minus another 1 time. So total of 10 minus 3 minus 3 minus 1, so 3. 3 xa. Plus xb and plus 5 xc1 and plus 9 xc2. So let me call this function, let's say z. This is the average of the three scores. Once you know that you studied for such and such amount of time, you know that the average of the grades that you will get is this. Okay. So our problem is maximizing this function. Even by doing just this, we already gain, well, a little bit of insight. We see that, say, studying for C on the second day is, well, quite a good idea, because you see that each hour of studying gives plus kind of 3 points to the average. But studying for B on the first day, well, might be a little bit less good idea. It gives to the average 1/3 of a point. So just formulating this is already a step in the right direction. But still it's not, well, it's not the answer. We still don't know, well, we do know that studying for C on the second day is a good idea. But is it good enough to justify kind of studying for C only on the second day? Or should we split studying for C between the second day and the first day? Not obvious. Should we concentrate all our efforts on studying for A? Or maybe we should, well, devote some amount of studying to B? Also not obvious. Well, but then we also didn't formulate this problem mathematically completely. We just know what kind of function we want to maximize. But of course not any kind of parameters will be good for us. I mean, of course, the larger all these numbers are, the larger z is. But if I choose xa to be, I don't know, 12, I didn't solve my problem. I cannot study for 12 hours on the first day. It's given to me in the problem. So I have some constraints, some things which describe what kind of strategies are plausible and what kind of strategies are not plausible for me. So let's discuss those constraints. already mentioned the constraint about studying for no more than 8 hours on each of the days. So let's just write it down. On the first day, I studied for XA plus XB plus XC 1 hours, and this should be at most 8. So if I employ any kind of strategy, I will want this constraint to be satisfied. Also, on the second day, I study for this amount of hours, and this should also be at most 8. Cool. Another constraint which is easy to forget about, but which is very important. You might give such a problem to a computer and it will give you the best strategy is, well, study for minus 5 hours on the first day, and so on. So it's not a good idea. You cannot study for minus 5 hours. You cannot kind of forget the material actually in 5 hours or something like this. So we should have such constraints. XA is positive, XB is positive, XC1 is positive, XC2 is positive. So now we satisfied all the obvious kind of time constraints. So each kind of assignment of these numbers will be a reasonable strategy for allocating our time on the first day and allocating our time on the second day. You can, once you have any kind of numbers, any four numbers that satisfy these inequalities, they're reasonable as a strategy for studying. So the first naive thought is, well, maybe we already formulated our problem well enough. And at this point, I wanted to ask you what would be wrong with this, but I already got an answer from here. But let me just kind of describe a hypothetical scenario in which we actually think that this is the correct problem. That just this problem is what we are trying to solve. Well, we'll try to solve it. For now, we don't have a means to solve it, but let's say we give to some black box, a computer, a problem with this formulation, and it spits out an answer. So let me go to this board. I want to have two boards. Okay, so if you give this problem, say, to a computer, or if you solve it by hand using the algorithms that you'll learn later, you'll get the following answer. Best strategy. Optimal solution, the best possible assignment of XA, XB, and XC1, XC2 that will give the largest value of this function is as follows. XA is A.
To have more than 100 for one grade, so I think we might want to make one constraint more.
Yes, so that's exactly what I'm trying to explain right now. Yes. So we will have a constraint that will restrict our grade to 100. But suppose that we kind of forgot about this constraint for now. Well, we will get some solution. It is in fact a reasonable solution. If you just look at this function, you see that the best strategy looks like maximizing these two variables. And that's exactly what this strategy is about. You just ignore A, ignore B, study for C on both days. And then you get fantastic scores. You get 41 for A, you get 16 for B, and you get 180 for C. Well, of course, you studied for 16 hours per seat, you started with, well, 20% of knowledge, and, well, 12 times 16 is 192, and, well, you gained quite a lot of knowledge, more than 100%. Well, of course, it's not reasonable. Even if you study, well, you can't study more than 100% of the material for the course. And it's not even about the fact that it's impossible to get a grade of more than 100. It's about the fact that you cannot study more than 100% of the material for the course. I mean, even if in the end you get kind of a reasonable answer, A is 41, B is 16, and C is 98. Well, you should realize that this 98 is the result of, well, getting some amount of knowledge and then subtracting this penalty for being tired. If you study for 8 hours, you get tired to the extent that you get 24 points less than what you actually know. So if you get kind of 98 for C, well, you already learned 120-something percent of the material. So we want to introduce some additional constraints. So the additional constraints will be you can't gain more than 100% of knowledge. So for A, you gain 65 plus 10x8% of knowledge, and this amount should be at most 100. For B, you get 40 plus 8xB amount of knowledge, and this should be at most 100. And for C, you get 20 plus 12 xc1 plus xc2, and this also should be at most 100.
Set it up so that it'd be an interval between 50 and 100, just so we don't get failures. And, I mean, you want to maximize an average, but you don't want to fail classes either.
Okay, so it might be a good idea, but as formulated in this problem, well, the actual problem was about just maximizing the average. Yes, you're right. If the student actually thought in advance well what he wants to get, he would, well, say, I want also to get all the grades at least 50.
But I don't think you would say greater than 50 there, because that's
already.
Yes,
not about the knowledge. Right. He doesn't want to get at least 50% of knowledge in the course, he wants a grade at least 50. So I might want to introduce some constraint like this grade for A, this amount is at least 50. But this particular student, though, didn't think in advance about this. So, we won't suggest to him something new. We'll just try to solve his problem.
Oh.
Yeah.
For your constraints, shouldn't it just be the grade should be less than 100 rather than the grade you get from just studying? Because you don't have the factor of being tired and losing grades in that equation.
Okay, so suppose that your strategy, the optimal strategy, is like this. For exam A, you study for, say, 4 hours. And then, well, you get tired, and in the end, you get a grade of 65 plus 10 times 4, which is a total of 105, and minus the penalty for studying, which is, well, let's say 20.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
So you get a reasonable grade of 85.
Yeah.
But actually, this is not reasonable, because this implies that you learned 65 plus 10 times 4, which is 105% of material for the course.
Mm-hmm.
But the material for the course is, well, it's just some fixed amount of material.
Mm-hmm.
It's, I don't know, this book. You can't learn 105% of this book. So this is the correct constraint. Okay. Next question is, are these constraints enough? Did you describe all possible inequalities or equalities or whatever constraints which must be satisfied? Well, the answer is, well, kind of yes. Maybe if you are very picky, it might be a little bit no. What do I mean? Well, a grade for a course could be negative, of course. I mean, you could start with, well, suppose that you don't study for C at all, and you don't study, and you get huge penalty for being tired, and in the end you get minus 5 for the exam. And it's a question of whether the exam actually allows you to get minus 5%, and that's a question about whether the actual formulation of the problem was correct. Do you actually get the penalty of 3 points for each hour of studying, or do you have some condition that, well, once you get to zero, you don't get any additional penalty? So, I mean, in a way, yes, these are all the constraints according to the formulation of the problem. The more realistic assumptions will fall for some additional constraints, each one of those grades being positive. Okay, so let's just stick with these constraints. And let me tell you the answer. The optimal strategy hours on the second day for exam C, and you rest for the other hour and one third. The scores that you are going to get are as follows: 76, 52, 72. And though these scores don't tell you kind of much about how much you actually gain the knowledge, so maybe let's compute also the knowledge. the amount of material that you actually learned is 100% for A, 76% for B, and 100% for C. So it turns out that the best strategy in this particular case is, so learn as much as you can for A, as much as you can for C, but only on the second day. Devote the rest of the first day to studying for D. And, well, once you study enough for C, just take a break. So once again, it wasn't at all obvious that this would be the best strategy by just looking at the problem. And we will develop in this course a method for actually obtaining these precise numbers. How many hours you should study for each one of these exams. And also, well, we'll later discuss the third step, which is about this thing that maybe we don't really want to get 52 on any exam. Maybe what we wanted to optimize wasn't actually the average. Maybe it was the lowest score of the three. Also, if you did, you know, learn also how to solve such problems. So, okay, so maybe the first question is about this example. So I, once again, didn't tell you how to get this answer, but at least I told you how to start with the problem and translated the mathematical problem. Find the maximum of this function under such and such constraints. So let me discuss, I still have 7 minutes, let me discuss these general things. What kind of problems, what are the standard problems that we will learn how to solve? So, we have to introduce some words for this. So first important notion is that of a linear function. That's any function of the following form. Some number times first parameter plus some number times second parameter and so on plus. Last number times last parameter. So C1 up to Cn are numbers. X1 to Xn are parameters. So any expression of this form, for example, this part of Z, 3xA plus Xb plus 5xC plus 9xC2, is called a linear function. Or let's say 10 times xA is a linear function. Then we have linear constraint. It's any kind of expression of the following kind, of the following form. Linear function equal or less than equal or greater than equal than a number. So every time you have such an equation written, it's called a linear constraint. You have a linear function must be either equal to a number, less than or equal to a number, or greater than or equal to a number. Then you have the kinds of problems that we are going to discuss will be all called linear programming problems. Linear programming problems. Each problem of this kind will look like this. Maximize or minimize. One of the two, a linear function, subject to, or under, finitely many, linear constraints. Any kind of problem where you have a linear function that you want to maximize or minimize, and you only have linear constraints about these the parameters, which means equalities like this or inequalities like this, linear function is equal to some number, or slower equal than some number, or greater equal than some number. This is called a linear programming problem. These are the problems that we will discuss in this course. Maybe just a word about terminology. Programming, I mean, today is associated with computer programming, But here the programming is not about computers. It's a kind of program in the sense of kind of strategy, the plan of actions, what you are going to do. Like here, each solution was a plan for actions, so it was called a program. Okay, and let me give you also a standard form for a linear programming problem. So a standard, or rather, linear programming problem in standard form. So we might want to translate all kinds of problems to some standard form, and this step maybe to give it to some algorithm or to some computer. So, and the standard form is like this. It's always maximize some function, Z, which is a linear function, subject to the following constraints. So the constraints will look like this. You'll have some linear functions. This will be the first one. Smaller or equal than some number. Always smaller or equal than. You'll have several of those. An1, x1 plus and so on plus an, xn smaller or equal than bn. So we have some constraints like this, and also all x1 through xn greater or equal than 0. So we'll say that the linear programming problem is in a standard form if all the variables must be positive, like in our problem that we just formulated. And if all the inequalities of the form, some linear function, all the constraints of the form, some linear function is smaller or equal than some number, and the question is to maximize some linear function. So we'll call such problems, well, standard problems. And we'll learn how to translate any kind of problem to a standard one, and then how to solve a standard one. So we'll talk more about this next time.